Good afternoon, everyone. My name is David Oleski, and I'm the acting special agent in charge with the Drug Enforcement Administration here in Denver. I would like to welcome all of you here this afternoon to our division office, and I specifically want to welcome and introduce the individuals and agencies who are joining me here today. First, Executive Director Keith Weiss of the Rocky Mountain HIDA, District Attorney John Kellner for the 18th Judicial District, Homeland Security Investigations, Acting Assistant Special Agent in Charge Robert Nieves. From the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office, we have Sheriff Tyler Brown. From the Douglas County Sheriff's Office, Chief Deputy Kevin Duffy and Captain Darren Weekly. From the Denver Police Department, we have Commander Paul Jimenez. And lastly, I'd like to welcome from the Arvada Police Department, Commander Anthony Barros. Today, we are here to highlight and discuss a multi-agency investigation involving federal, state, and local partners, which took place here in the Denver metro area over the course of the past 8 months and concluded over the past of the last couple of weeks. This investigation is a model example for interagency partnership, utilizing a full array of investigative techniques and a focus on community impact. This investigation is also an example for the many unfortunate trends which we are seeing in the region, namely the flooding of our communities with both methamphetamine and the even more deadly counterfeit prescription pills laced with fentanyl. This investigation also too often confirmed the strong correlation that exists between the trafficking of illegal drugs and violent crime. This investigation was initiated in April of 2021 and targeted a polydrug trafficking organization based in Colorado, led by Saul Ramon Rivera Beltran. As a result of an assortment of investigative techniques, investigators linked this drug trafficking organization to one of the most violent and powerful drug trafficking organizations based in Mexico, the Sinaloa Cartel. Investigators uncovered its distribution network in the region, which touched a wider range of cities and counties in the area, to include Commerce City, Aurora, Denver, Thornton, Arvada, and Lakewood. In addition, a number of significant events took place in both Douglas and Arapahoe counties. This organization was responsible for trafficking methamphetamine, cocaine, heroin, and counterfeit prescription pills laced with fentanyl. This investigation resulted in seizures totaling more than 110,000 counterfeit pills laced with the deadly fentanyl. Recently, DEA laboratory testing revealed that on average, 2 out of every 5 counterfeit pills laced with fentanyl contains a potential lethal dose, revealing that seizures made throughout this investigation prevented more than 40,000 lethal doses of fentanyl from reaching our communities. The defendants apprehended during this investigation were collectively responsible for coordinating the transportation of these drugs, as well as their packaging and distribution. Intelligence gathered throughout this investigation indicated that these pills can be manufactured in Mexico for as little as 4 cents per pill and sold wholesale here in the Denver area for as little as $3 or retail for between $10 to $20. This organization and its members had no regard for the impact their activities had on our community. It was all about greed and making money. In addition to the more than 100,000 fentanyl-laced pills seized, investigators also seized more than 6 kilograms of methamphetamine, 8 pounds of heroin, 11 kilograms of cocaine, and approximately $450,000 in U.S. currency from this organization over the course of the 8-month investigation. This investigation also reaffirmed the nexus between drug trafficking and violent crime, with 28 firearms seized, multiple hand grenades, high-capacity magazines, and several sets of body armor. This organization was preparing for a battle, one which played out on multiple occasions throughout the investigation. Also, the investigation revealed targets of the investigation would recklessly shoot their firearms out the windows of their vehicles in celebratory fashion, or fire rounds in their backyards for fun. Whether you choose to focus on the pills that this organization trafficked, or the combination of grenades and firearms which were seized, or the individuals whom were responsible for it all who were apprehended, the success of the operation was only made possible as a result of the strong partnerships we have with all of our law enforcement partners standing before you today. And on behalf of all of us from DEA, we are grateful for those partnerships. At this time, I would like to introduce Keith Weiss, who is the Executive Director for HIDA's Rocky Mountain region.
Thank you, Acting Sec. Oleski. As Mr. Oleski said, my name is Keith Wise. I'm the Executive Director for the Rocky Mountain HIDA High Intensity Drug Trafficking Area Program based here in Denver, Colorado. The Rocky Mountain HIDA is supported by the Office of National Drug Control Policy and has an overarching goal of bringing together law enforcement agencies at every level to reduce violence and the trafficking of the most dangerous narcotics that are impacting our communities. Today, Denver and several surrounding communities are much safer because of this unified law enforcement partnership dealing a blow to the worst of the worst criminal elements pushing deadly fentanyl. There is a national drug crisis in this country that has claimed more than 100,000 victims for the first time ever. Over the last year, there's been over a 30% increase in fatal overdoses across our country. We are not immune from this crisis. We've also experienced a 30% increase regionally, but unfortunately here in Colorado, the numbers are higher at a 46% increase in drug overdose deaths. The investigation being briefed here today is a stellar example of law enforcement actions protecting our communities from violence and rising numbers of overdoses. The leadership of this polydrug distribution organization has been disrupted and are associated with the dangerous weapons displayed here while conducting their illegal enterprise to push high-grade stimulants such as methamphetamine, cocaine, along with depressants such as heroin and the worst of the worst, which are synthetic pills laced with fentanyl. It is widely known that it just takes one fentanyl-laced pill to take a life. These narcotics are produced in clandestine laboratories with absolutely no quality controls or regulation, and are the primary cause of the elevated overdose incidents that sadly are resulting in more and more deaths. This effort alone, over 100,000 of these pills have been seized, never making it to the streets, and the people most responsible for its distribution indicted and arrested. By cutting off the stream of the availability of these extremely dangerous narcotics, invaluable time and space has been created for prevention and treatment specialists to continue their crucial roles of outreach to those individuals needing the resources. So without a doubt, our law enforcement professionals here today have saved lives of Coloradans. This complex criminal investigation required the resources and expertise from numerous agencies, both on the investigative and prosecutorial sides. It is these invaluable partnerships and shared goals of protecting our communities that are the recipe for success. On the behalf of the Rocky Mountain HIDA, I want to commend the outstanding and noteworthy teamwork between the U.S. Drug Enforcement Administration, the Denver Police Department, the Douglas County Sheriff's Office, the Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office, the Arvada Police Department, Homeland Security Investigations, and the District Attorney's Office for the 18th Judicial District for the state of Colorado. It is now my pleasure to introduce District Attorney John Kellner.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is John Kellner. I'm the District Attorney for the 18th Judicial District, representing Arapahoe, Douglas, Elbert, and Lincoln counties. Now, the first thing I want to do is I want to recognize the outstanding efforts of our organized crime unit led by my Chief Deputy District Attorney, Darcy Kofel. She has built this unit into the go-to unit for these kinds of investigations throughout our state, and especially in the metro area. And if you look back at the news clippings, you will see this kind of work repeatedly come out of the 18th Judicial District DA's office. And that's because of the hard work of her and her team. Now, what do I hope you take away from this amazing indictment today of 19 people who are peddling poison in our community? Is that one pill alone can kill. And if you look at that over there and you see 110,000 pills in bags, About 40% of those, 40% are estimated to be lethal doses of fentanyl. So think about that. The work of this team has potentially thwarted over 40,000 deaths in our community. This is not a victimless crime. Drug distribution in our community has resulted in the seizure of some 24 plus firearms. This stuff right here, high capacity magazines, these weapons, these are the weapons that drug distributors are carrying around in our communities. This is not a victimless crime. Over 500 Coloradans died from fentanyl last year. We are on track to have over 700 fentanyl overdose deaths this year in Colorado. What we are doing with this indictment and with the work of this law enforcement team is to take the distributors off the street. But we cannot accomplish this goal alone, because the fact of the matter is, this poison is coming over from our southern border unchecked. It will not stop coming over the border from Mexico into our communities until the federal government takes that porous border seriously. We need to put an end to the throughput that is coming in here and killing our friends and family. Thank you for being here today. I'm happy to take any questions.
What policies would you like to see change at the border to stop it?
I'm going to start with what I'd like to see changed in the state of Colorado. Colorado's drug laws, especially when it comes to fentanyl, are behind the times. Right now, it's 4 grams of fentanyl is a drug misdemeanor level 1 to have that in your possession. Now, what does it take to kill somebody? 2 milligrams. Think about that NutraSweet packet that you put in your coffee every morning. Just 2 little grains of that can kill somebody. So what we allow people to carry around as a misdemeanor is actually enough to kill over 1,000 people. And that allows drug distributors to potentially walk around with too much of this and then face almost no consequences. That's number one. The other thing that Colorado needs to do is we need to have a sentence enhancer, much like the federal government has, for drug distribution causing death. And what that would do is it would raise the penalty for the people that peddle this poison, so that when they do this and somebody dies, they are going to prison for a long time, because the message needs to be sent that we will not tolerate this in Colorado. Other questions? Or for these gentlemen?
They're being indicted on the 18th, but should we expect federal charges as well? Or?
I can't speak for federal charges. This case was brought to my office, and so it was charged through our grand jury. So we have a state level case going on. Typically, there's not a federal case going on at the same time. So we've got 19 different individuals. The leader of this group is being held on a $1 million bond. There are several people on $750,000 or $500,000 bonds, and we're going to bring them to justice and face accountability in our state courts.
Were they hiding in plain sight? Where were these people? Were they all live in the same place? Can you tell us more about the operation?
Sure. So I would encourage anybody to go get a copy of the indictment. It's lengthy and answers a lot of the specific questions as well about the ins and outs of the investigation. But by and large, these are distributed networks. I mean, they do not just, you know, reside in one home and operate out of that. As you heard these gentlemen mention, this organization trafficked throughout the entire metro area. So it's not just our community in Arapahoe and Douglas County or the 18th Judicial District. It's around Denver. It's in Thornton. Obviously, it's in Aurora as well. So it's been all over the place.
Are we talking a residential home? And what did it look like? What did the operation look like?
So it definitely varied. You know, some people live in a residential home. Other people will live in an apartment. But they don't typically distribute it out of their place where they live. Now, when these folks talk about engaging every aspect of our law enforcement capabilities, they're talking about surveillance methods. They're talking about wiretaps and using those means to basically figure out how the organization works and then to have a coordinated takedown. Do you gentlemen want to elaborate on that?
Sure.
or how the operation worked?
What I'll say first to your question is that when we're talking overdose deaths and we talk about the number over 100,000, there's no part of our nation that's immune from it. There's no part of Colorado that's immune from it. And I think when we start talking about this story of overdose deaths, people think that it's in some far off place. Or if we're talking about the violence, if we're talking about these firearms and the trafficking of these narcotics, people think it's somewhere else in the country. And I think this investigation has showed, unfortunately, the window that we see through in law enforcement. We're sharing that with all of you today to make sure that everyone is aware of what our community is facing. And as you might have phrased, hiding in plain sight, that's the job of us in law enforcement to identify these individuals, locate them, gather the evidence, and then work with our partners to put them behind bars. So I think that unfortunately I listed earlier today the handful of cities, and it was a breadth of scope just in terms of the whole region and counties that this touched. And I just think it was amazing work by our investigative team to put this and our prosecution team to put this together.
How did y'all connect these pills to the Sinaloa cartel? How do you know they're from Mexico?
Well, in terms of the connection, I think that's a more lengthy process of being able to explain on how. But what I will say in terms of the pills and seized, and you can see in the photos that we have here today, you know, about a decade ago, if you found these blue M30 oxycodone pills on the street, one could be led to believe that they were diverted from a legitimate pharmacy. That is not the case. Over the last decade, DEA, we've tightened and helped, created tactical diversion teams. We've increased, our oversight of the process by which legitimate oxycodone pills were being diverted in the past. What you're finding now on the streets in our communities are 100% manufactured south of our border. And when somebody acquires one of these pills, they should not trust that this pill is what it pretends to be, an oxycodone pill. And what I would tell the communities, anyone listening and watching, is that unless you get your medications from a licensed medical, doctor or pharmacy, I can tell you that these pills that you're finding, whether they're trafficked on the streets or on the internet, that they are going to be a pill manufactured south of our border. And, in years past, it might have been the case that if you were trying to acquire these pills, that you might have to go to a dark alley or a dangerous part of town. But also what we're seeing, just generally speaking, not per se in this particular case, but that these counterfeit pills are being trafficked on social media websites, TikTok, Snapchat,